time and space. Everywhere and anywhere, every star that ever was. Where do you want to start?
Hello and welcome to a brand new series of All of Time and Space. I'm Iain.
And I'm Mark. And this time round we'll be looking at the Planet of Giants, which is story one from season two.
And what happens in Planet of the Giants, Mark?
Well, I'm glad you asked me that, Iain, because I've got the blurb from the back of the Target book here. So just to get everyone up to speed. The Doctor is feeling confident. This time the TARDIS has landed on Earth, in England, in 1963. But when he and his companions venture outside, they're soon lost in a maze of ravines and menaced by gigantic insects, and the insects are dying. Every living thing is dying. Meanwhile, in a cottage garden on a perfect summer's day, the man from the Ministry arrives to put a stop to the production of DN6, a pesticide with the power to destroy all life forms. But the men who invented DN6 will stop at nothing, not even murder, in their desire to see DN6 succeed. Can the one-inch tall Doctor foil their plans? Well, we'll find out after this.
The most dangerous moment is at the point of materialization. The most dangerous.
Close the door! What do you mean, close the door?
Don't argue with your boy, it's emergency. Close the door!
They opened.
Doors open before we properly materialize.
But what does it mean?
We have been reduced roughly to the size of an inch.
An inch? I can see a huge leg coming.
You'd do anything to get what you want, wouldn't you?
There's nothing but death all around us.
The experiment must go through.
It gets more horrifying every moment.
Can get us back to normal size.
Oh, you know? Yes, of course I can, dear boy, yes.
Barbara!
Of course I can. I hope.
And welcome back. And I'm really pleased to say we're joined today by one of my podcasting heroes. It's Eric Escamilla. Hello, Eric.
Hello, it is me. Yes, the genuine article. Glad to be here. Not as big as my normal studios, but this will do.
Well, we didn't get the rider until 10 minutes ago. I'm still trying to get the bowl of M&Ms, but take out all the brown ones yeah. and all the put in more yes. of the... just give me another 5 minutes, basically.
No problem.
I'm working
no
on
problem.
It. I'm working on it.
Thank you. No, it's my honor to... a little bit come out of my Doctor Who podcasting hiatus or retirement, not really retirement, but hiatus. Mm-hmm. I'm always happy to talk about it. That's for sure. That's never changed.
Well, that's good. Yeah. I mean, without wishing to gush too much, one of the reasons why I got into podcasting in the first place was I really loved a podcast out there called Mostly Harmless Cutaway, which was produced by a certain Mr. Eric Escamilla, and that got me hooked, and I just loved that show, and I figured, well, maybe I could have a go. Obviously nowhere near the sort of quality that you guys could do, but
that's so silly. I mean, thank you, but it's just us mucking about is what it always was.
Uh-huh.
But I appreciate it, and actually
it was entertaining mucking about.
It's probably been at least a year and a half since there was a release on that feed. But, mm-hmm. you know, you're hearing
2018.
What's that? 2018, you said?
It was 2018.
Really? Okay, uh-huh. So 2 years. But who's counting? But, you know, you'll hear it here first.
Mark's counting.
I sit there every day refreshing the feed and there's just nothing going on. I mean,
it's like Chinese democracy all over again.
Oh dear.
Well, I'm here to say it out loud first, which is that myself and Josh and Sean, we actually did record something relevant to New Who, man, but we recorded it, I don't know, 6-8 months ago, something like that. And I've just been sitting on it, a brand new, mostly Harmless cutaway. So just keep egging me on and I shall release that.
That's just like the good old days, because you used to have, you know, hundreds of episodes lying around. It's almost like the Doctor Who missing episodes.
Many of those are
tape
still
all over your cutting room floor.
It's true. Many of those are still lying around. I still have them on external hard drives. There are still a fair amount of unpublished episodes. But I definitely had the intention of releasing this latest recording, since it actually pertained to current Who and everything. It was actually topical for once. So everyone, if you know me on Twitter, egg me on, and perhaps that will see the light of day sometime soon. Because it's ready. It's there.
You may regret having said that.
All right. I'll take that. I'll take that.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you along for the ride.
It is. But before we go any further, I think it's probably time to test the guest. Eric, it's time for you to face the mind probe.
No, not the mind probe.
So, the quiz this time, Planet of Giants, which we're here to talk about, is the first story from season 2 of Doctor Who. So I want you to tell me which TV series the following episodes are all taken from. They are all season 2 episode 1s. Does that sound vaguely look sensible?
Yes. Okay. Ready.
Excellent. Right. Okay. We've got 10 questions. I'll read them all out, not in one go. Give it your best shot. You'll be judged. You'll be rated. And if you do very badly, you're going to get tossed into the time lash. So I would try and avoid that fate if I were you.
I like time lash. Fun fact. But go on.
Well, there's always one. Okay. Question.
Eric has dreamed about being tossed into the time lash. But anyway, let's move on.
Tossing with tinsel. Okay, so episode number 1, When She Was Bad. Which show is that? Season 2, episode 1 of.
My goodness, I have... When She Was Bad. I have not a clue. I do not know. And these are all random series, by the way.
These are all totally random TV shows that I've spent the afternoon Googling.
I don't know.
And this was Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Oh. So I actually did
question
see it.
Number...
Okay.
Oh, well, good. So, I couldn't remember it was called that either. But, Number 2, New Earth.
Okay. That would be Doctor Who Series 2.
That would be a point to you, sir.
Oh, thank you.
Number three. Guy walks into a psychiatrist's office.
I don't know, but I'm just going to throw out The Sopranos.
It is The Sopranos.
There we go.
What an excellent guess that was. Well done.
Thank you, me.
Number four, or question four, I should say. I should try and sound more sort of presenterly, shouldn't I? Question four. The North remembers.
Okay. Let's just go with Game of Thrones.
It is the Game of the Thrones. Well done.
Thank you.
Number five. Redemption.
I know I'm going to be upset when you tell me the answer, but I'm just going to go with the series Lost.
It's not, I'm afraid. It was the series Blake Seven.
Oh, I would not know that.
Fair enough. I realize that now in my stupidity.
No. I should have watched
Question six. This is another series two, episode one. This one's called Amok Time.
Oh, yeah, of course. Star Trek, the original series.
Oh, well done. Yes, classic.
Absolutely.
The next one is 737.
Jesus, sounds like this could be lost as well. Jeez, I'm just going to go with lost again.
It was not lost. It was Breaking Bad.
Oh! Man.
Okay, easy one next. Easy one now. Number eight, In the Shadow of Two Gunmen.
You said easy one?
I did. That was possibly misleading.
The Shadow. Shadow of Two Gunmen. Ring any bells? Oh, I hope not to be angry when you give me the answer.
Well, the answer was The West Wing.
Oh, no. Oh. Okay, I wouldn't know that.
Okay, number nine, A Lie Agreed Upon.
I'm just going to go with Grey's Anatomy, even though I know nothing about the show.
Ooh. No, I'm afraid it was Deadwood, the classic western from
another one
about
I haven't
10
seen
years
before.
Ago. You haven't seen Deadwood? Oh, I'll lend you the box set. It's fantastic.
I have access to
and
it.
And finally, good. Oh well, that's interesting. Finally, question number 10. This is a season 2, episode 1. May the Giant Be With You.
I'm going to go with Fraggle Rock.
Oh, I'm literally bleeding. That was Twin Peaks.
Oh!
So,
very much the same, to be fair.
Right, you and me, after school, I'm gonna duff you up, Cockrum. Eric, I calculate through the medium of looking at my little scribbles that you've got 4 out of 10.
Oh, better than
so
I thought.
Congratulations, Eric.
I'm afraid at the end of the episode you are going to be tossed into the time lash quite vigorously.
Oh, goody.
By Mark.
What a way to go.
Oh, goody. I look forward to that, by the way, so. I just want the audience to know I was in no way prepped for that, not even to know there was a quiz, much less the topic of the quiz.
Nobody expects the quiz.
Well, I mean, I was amazed you got the Star Trek one right, because you're not a big Star Trek fan, are you, Eric?
Not at all. Fun fact, I try to include one oblique Star Trek reference in every Best Picture podcast, but I forget. Sometimes that's why they're not always there, but I do have one ready to go just about every week.
So, Mark, do you want to lead us off on today's topic?
Yeah, we should really get to the matter in hand. We are going to talk about Season 2, Story 1, Planet of Giants. So this is an idea that has been kind of thrown around since the very inception of the programme, and they wanted to make it the opening story, and that didn't really pan out because they realised that the budget just wasn't there to achieve the story that they had commissioned. So it got held over to season two. They went with a new writer with a different idea, and what we got was Planet of Giants.
Can I come in like a juggernaut at this point and say I support that decision? I think this would have been a very terrible thing to go into on the back of an unearthly child. It would have set up the show as this kind of weird magical box of delights kind of thing rather than the show it is now. So that's my two penneth.
Very agreed with that statement. It would have been really, really confusing because you would just think, if you want to set up the premise that it's a quote unquote time travel show, you're really muddying things up at the very, very beginning. If you do a different type of change of dimension right off the bat, it would just be very confusing. you would just think it's a fantastical show or just fantastical things happen in general.
Now, Eric.
Yes.
One of the reasons for me, apart from you being a great podcaster, one of the reasons for me asking you to come on this particular show is that you have a particular penchant for stories where the characters become teeny weeny.
Yes. Well, yes, mostly that, but it can go the other way. Something could get made larger in scale as well. Kind of go both ways in that. I more describe it as when there's a significant change in scale. But more often than not, it is our protagonists shrinking. Sure, that's fine. And we did not discuss this either prior, but I suspected this was the reason you were inviting me onto this particular episode. I highly suspected this. And that is true. That is how I have long felt, independent of Doctor Who. It's something I always had a thing for, and it really jumped out at me this episode when I saw it for my first time, approximately 9 or 10 years ago.
Okay. So how would you have seen this? Was this on, like, cable TV? Or
no. No. Doctor Who's... aside from the new series, but classic Doctor Who has virtually never been on cable television ever in the United States. There was other ways and other means.
Of course, you have your PBS thing, don't you? With the
in the old days, that was the way.
Fundraisers but and that kind of stuff. Yeah.
That was definitely the way in the old days, but that kind of ended after the 90s for most people. Not all, but most.
Right.
No, but this particular story, it was... probably it was already out on DVD in the United States as well at the time when I was seeking it out, but even then I don't think I saw it that way. I may have seen it the three parts being posted on YouTube or one of the other services like Daily Motion or Vimeo or something, and I think I did it that way. And the reason I got to it, and I don't remember exactly when, but it was probably around 2011, 2012, something like that. It was because I finally decided to start sort of not a rewatch, because a lot of it was my initial watch of all of Doctor Who from the very beginning. Mm-hmm. So I was going through, obviously, the Hartnell time, and I was mostly buying them all. And for some reason, I didn't. Maybe it was already hard to get. I don't remember what the reason why I didn't actually buy it. But I had started going story by story of the existing Hartnells, and I just came up to this one, like, in the order. And I didn't know anything. I knew almost nothing about it. I had heard bad things about it. People were telling me, oh, okay, yeah, Planet Giants, oh, get ready for that. But no one spoiled anything about the story or the plot or what it would even deal with. So I flew into it blindly, not expecting the story to be what it is.
Yeah, it's certainly a change of tone, I think, from what we've had so far. Can you imagine too many children's shows today that have someone being murdered? And you know, it's pretty full on, isn't it?
It
by today's standards.
Most don't, but there's a few subtle children's shows, at least in America. I don't want to take a side trip like I am known for, but Clone Wars, the animated, it wasn't Disney originally, but the animated Star Wars series was supposedly billed as children's programming. And I love that show. Yeah. I've watched it all, but I've constantly railed that it has to be the children's program with the most death and suicide and torture throughout the series. And it really is, and it's a little mind-blowing in that way. But if you give me some more time, I think of a few other modern children's programs that seem a little bit questionable but
a bit murdery. Well, let's give you a bit of thinking time. Eric Mark, when did you first see Planet of Giants?
Oh, blimey. I think it must have been on the DVD release, because Way back in the day, in the 90s, this is another difference between the US and the UK. So, as we've mentioned many times before, the BBC weren't really that keen to repeat Doctor Who on network TV. So the only way you could really get a fix of Doctor Who on broadcast TV was to go to satellite TV. And there was a station called UK Gold. And they acquired the rights to show the old stuff. So I watched a lot of the old Hartnell stuff on that, but I don't remember seeing Planet of Giants. So I think it must have been on the DVD release. So yeah, relatively recently.
Okay.
Do you have what about you, Ian? Have you seen this before?
I saw it this morning. I watched it this morning before I had my toast.
Wait, that's your first viewing, or no?
Yeah, yeah. I haven't really watched a lot of 60s Doctor Who. I mean, the War Games, The Unearthly Child.
The War Game.
Probably a couple of others. But I was very much an 80s child and 80s fanboy. So, yeah.
Eric's a big fan of the War Games, aren't you, Eric?
That's a long-going meme, or whatever you want to call it, on my podcast. Because to date, there's approximately 5 or 6 existing stories that I have never seen. And as I was getting approaching that number, when the number was shrinking, 12, 11, 10, when I was starting to watch those I'd never seen, the closer I got to zero, the more I started to feel like, oh, I kind of want to cherish these, or I want to save them for a moment of big discussion on the podcast. So the War Games, because of course I knew it was going out of print in the United States when it was a long time ago, I secured a copy. Yeah. And I've had it for all these years, and it's still wrapped in its cellophane. And my friends who know about it think I'm crazy for not cracking it open and watching it.
Days.
So I've been saving it for some special time.
Just to get you up to speed, Eric, we're in the middle of a global pandemic. There are numerous countries around the world who used to be considered, you know, relatively decent countries who are now appearing to go the way of sort of totalitarian, some might even say fascist regimes.
Okay. I'm writing this down.
What is it going to take for you to break that seal on the War Games? What Mark is saying is
the world is on fire, and if you don't watch it now, then what in the hell are you waiting for?
I thought you guys were going to say I need to watch it now more than ever because it's germane to our times. That's the angle I thought you guys were about to take right now.
Watch it while you still got the chance.
I don't know. I don't want to. What's the word? It's not really. I'm also known for malapropisms, but I don't know if it's breaking the fourth wall or not at all. When I say, I'm aware of the global pandemic. That sounds funny, but if you guys were in my sphere in South Central Texas, while it has affected me, it hasn't affected my life very much because of where I am geographically. So when I hear what you guys are saying, or what other friends in other places are saying, or when I just turn on the news, I almost feel like I'm viewing, it's like the, what is it called? That portal in the classic Star Trek episode, not the Doomsday, but the one, you know,
City on the Edge of
Forever. Yes, that episode, and I can't remember what the device is called. But when I see everything that's going on in the world today, nationally and internationally, I feel like I'm viewing things through that portal because I feel very removed from it myself. So I have a tough time just engaging with all my other friends who are going through hell right now because I just feel detached from it. So I'm sorry, I don't want to be a downer, but... my life is...
Well, that's probably a good way to protect your own sort of mental well-being, really, isn't it?
Well, yeah, that's why I haven't been affected hardly, and I feel a little bit bad because that's not the way it is for the rest of my friends and everybody else I know. So, yes, that's...
I think you wanna watch the War Games. You want to make it last as long as you can. Watch one episode a week, and I guarantee you the best 10 weeks of your life.
Wow, that is saying something.
That might be a bold claim, I don't know, but...
I will watch it.
Track that. Oh, I want you to watch the War Games. You notice how we're talking around the subject of, you know, we're talking about anything but Planet of Giants. And I wonder if that's significant.
No, it's no, it shouldn't be. Let me try to get back on track to Planet of Giants.
Uh-huh.
So like I said, I got to this and I played it not knowing what at all to expect from the story. And right off the bat, you know, it doesn't take very long into the story to realize it does involve shrinking people. And although there was a couple other classic stories that kind of had a similar, not gimmick, but device, not the way it's presented in this particular story. And I never would have expected this type of story, especially during the first Doctor's run. And again, I was going through Hartnell's, you know, chronologically at the time, and I just couldn't believe it after seeing, you know, the episodes that precede it. I couldn't believe that this is how we were going to kick off the second season of the show. I was delighted from the first moment when I realized what was going on. I just really, really couldn't believe it. And because of my bias, I guess, it caused me to enjoy it much, much more, I guess, than the standard viewer seeing it now, all these years later, for the first time. Because with the preceding Hartnell stories, yes, there was some I quite liked or was already familiar with, and then there was others where, oh, I just want to get through it, you know. Yeah, you kind of see. I mean, I'm preaching to the choir out there, but you get a feel for what the production was like in that era and how things were done and how they present the stories and how the scripts unfold. So you kind of expected certain things. But man, this miniaturism, oh my God, it tickled me to no end. If anything, I was angry that it only had 3 episodes and not at least 4. At the time, and I was simply,
well, that's a story in itself, isn't it?
Yes, and I was just simply delighted by it. I mean, despite its shortcomings, no pun intended, I don't plan those things. Yes, I can still recognize where it lacks as a Doctor Who story on screen. Of course, I'm aware of that, but just the sheer visual delight made up for it so much for me. And I hadn't seen it again until now. You know, so it's been nearly 10 years. I didn't have quite the same feeling about it now, but it still holds a bit of a special place because of my penchant, as Mark says.
Just to focus on some positive things, because I do get the suspicion we are possibly going to go a bit negative at some point. I think the sets are, when you consider how much money they have, I think the sets are pretty impressive. Particularly the sink. That, for me, was the standout. I thought that was really incredible for 1962.
I'm going to cut in here. I love the sink. I love that enormous wooden briefcase that they get to play around in. I think there were some incredibly well-realized sets. My only problem with the sink is that when Iain and Barbara finally climb down into it, when the water has just drained away, shouldn't it be a little damp?
I did notice that upon rewatch, and that is quite noticeable now. But I actually, as much as I love the sink, I actually have another quibble with it that I've had. That I still have.
Okay.
Well, I mean, okay, I didn't get out a ruler or anything, but it has bothered me, and it still bothered me, that the stopper is too small for the drain. that bothers me, because I don't know how it could possibly function when its circumference is less than the drain appears to be. I'm not going to let that wreck the whole story for me. But it does bother me, as good as it looks, that the stopper is a bit...
That is an amazing observation. I was trying to sort of think around the corner of what you could possibly have found fault with there, and I thought, surely the plug wasn't too small for the hole. But, I mean, when we have this trope over here, probably over there as well. You had one job, you know? And if you're making a sink, what is a sink if it's not a plug and a plug hole in some, you know, curved enamel? So, I mean, yes, that is astonishing, but very well realised. The matchbox less so for me. That looked slightly too thin. I don't know.
I thought the ant and the worm were pretty impressive. I thought they did the job.
The ant,
so to speak.
The ant was lovely. The worm, what I like about the worm is that the Doctor and Barbara sort of say goodbye to Iain and Susan. You know, we'll go this way, you go that way. They walk, and I counted 4 paces, and suddenly they're confronted by this giant worm that no one noticed a minute ago. Oh, hello.
Well, I think that a little bit gets addressed in some listener feedback I've been told about in preparation for this. And I also had things to say about that in general, even before I knew about the feedback. And that just applies to things that I've thought about before in the Hartnell era in particular. Not just within this single story, but with many stories.
I'm interested. What particularly grabbed you about this story? Because obviously we know about your liking for people getting drunk. What was it about the plot or the story that really gripped you?
Well, okay. To be fair, especially going back to the first time I saw it, the plot or story was neither here nor there for me. To be honest. And if you would have asked me what the actual plot or story was, I didn't remember until I watched it now in preparation. And I have more thoughts about that now, since obviously I was focusing more on it. But to be honest, it was the first thing and the big thing, again, no pun, was the production values, as we've discussed. I just couldn't believe what they were able to accomplish on their budget and on their time and budget. But also, like, you know, I couldn't even imagine, because I would love there to be a modern story that somehow uses this device. And there was one story during the Matt Smith era. I don't have the title in front of me, but that a little bit delved into shrinking of characters. Do you guys remember that episode?
No. Oh, my God.
I'm trying to think.
And nothing to do with the Master,
Capaldi,
by the way.
One where they go inside the Dalek, wasn't there?
Oh, yeah. I forgot that one. But that's not the one I'm thinking of. That was another good one for that reason. No, there was another one with Amy and Rory. I can't think of the name of the title, but it was the one...
Oh, yeah. Night Terrors.
Yes, that was it. With the cross father and the little boy. Yes, and it actually took me a while when I was watching that episode to grasp what was going on there, and how they had shrunken down. But that one aside, and the Capaldi episode, you see, you'd certainly wouldn't expect them to do a full on shrinkage story in modern times, because, you know, modern audiences have a certain type of expectation, and it would involve so much, especially if they're outdoors. See, it's one thing if they're in a dollhouse or inside a fictional Dalek creature. It'd be another thing if they were just out in the countryside or whatever. I mean, it just seems like it would be extremely difficult to do with modern expectations and everything. So it's just amazing they could pull something off like this with all the limitations that we understand at the time. It's really mind-blowing. And although... you know how they would do it, I was just shocked, like with the cliffhanger the first time when they encounter the cat and things like that. And it's just, or just when they come up that, or just when they come across the deceased man's face lying on the ground. And we get how it's done, but still, I couldn't believe I was seeing imagery like that in 60s black and white Doctor Who. It's just mind blowing.
I thought that was really well realized.
Absolutely, absolutely. Because I don't know where my penchant for this device started, but I think my earliest memory of seeing something like this, I mean, with shrinkage, was, the original, was it called The Incredible Shrinking Man? It was black and white. I don't know if you guys are aware of it, or I couldn't tell you who starred in it, but it was a black and white American film. And I know of it.
I haven't seen it.
That was a movie I saw a lot when I was quite young. And this reminded me of that because of the black and white and because of in the movie how he encounters some spiders and has to kill them with needles, sewing needles and things like that.
Oh, my God.
And it just reminded me of that. And I just couldn't believe because of the budget and because of the way we know black and white Doctor Who. Now, the story itself, that's something I focused on more, you know, now and really looking at everything. Mm-hmm. And I understand the criticism that is out there. You know, it is a bare bones plot.
I think in a lot of ways it's ahead of its time, the whole ecological message that's coming through.
There's definitely that, and that is surprising. Because, again, you don't expect it. But the actual plot itself, I understand it's rather thin. Some people point out, or I had read that a reviewer at the time had said that had criticized it because our protagonists have virtually no involvement with the antagonists. You know, they don't, they're working independently of all that. Yeah. And, you know, it's, of course, you have to stretch your imagination for some of the resolution of the problem. And it is all rather neatly tied up. I mean, you could just say, all this is going on with the standard size humans. Their story is going on, and then you could just say it's all foiled by a phone like being left off the hook, and that's really the whole story. Like if you really, you know, get down to it,
pretty much, yeah.
and it just kind of it just kind of works itself out just like that. But that doesn't bother me at all. Again, I'm super biased towards this one. For the aforementioned reasons. So just for the spectacle and the delight of it all, I'm completely on board and I still enjoyed it. Despite the easy things people can pick apart. There was something else I wanted to say about all that. I don't know. Someone say something and maybe it'll come back to me.
Okay. Well, let me sort of circle back to our chat about the cat. So, I have two things to say about the cat. Firstly, in extreme close-up at the cliffhanger, that is the most bored and disinterested-looking cat I've ever seen. You can tell from its sort of baleful gaze, it's like, what am I doing? I wanted to be in Shakespeare. Why am I in Doctor Who? Oh. But then there is a shot, I think early on in episode two, where it goes from a close-up of the cat to a long shot of the body of Pharaoh. And the cat, you can see the cat kind of run away from the head end of Pharaoh. As if on cue, as if someone has trained the cat to do that. And cats are notoriously difficult to kind of corral and wrangle. They won't be trained. They won't do rehearsals. So that, I think, was an incredibly brave decision to even attempt to film anything with a real cat. I don't know how long they spent.
The cat had a bigger part to play because this was originally filmed as four parts.
Oh, of course. Yes, I'd forgotten that
earlier. But a decision was made that it should be cut down to three. So they kind of combined parts three and four, and the cat was unfortunately going to suffer an untimely demise because it eats some of the grain and then pegs out. So I don't know. I'm guessing Eric may have seen this because we both have the DVD version. They have done a kind of reconstruction of parts three and four as a DVD extra. Did they have that on BritBox as well, or is it just purely the three parts?
It was just the three parts. I had no extra. Oh dear.
But
so did you watch the recon, Eric? Or
I watched some of it because I didn't have, due to time constraints, not because I didn't want to. But that was fascinating in of itself. I didn't realize that. Oh my dear, what's his last name? Oh my gosh. who sort of helped organize the whole thing, the remake. What's his name? I feel so bad.
Iain Levine.
Yes, Iain Levine. I had no idea he had been doing things like that for the BBC line of DVD releases since back then. I thought that was something he started doing a little bit more recently. Had no idea. It was a delightful extra. It's amazing. Like, I didn't know that extra existed, and it's just amazing to me, like, the time and effort all those people put into that. It's ridiculous for a story that most people don't highly laud in any type of way. Like, it's just about as ridiculous as if they made, like, an animated reconstruction for the 3 and 4 that never existed. Like, because that would be ridiculous. Who would do that? Who would commission that? Not only did they, you know, remake it, which I understand because there's been many reconstructions of lost episodes. We all get that. And this was kind of made kind of like that, except that they even got the living actors to be involved to reprise their roles. That's insane.
Well, here's the thing. The two living actors that took part in this story are William Russell and Carol Ann Ford. Every other person who was involved as an actor in that production had all passed away.
Absolutely. And well, then they had a William Hartnell impersonator.
He was very good, actually. I thought he was.
Yes, but the fact that they went through all this trouble to make a fan extra that most people won't even ever watch, either because they won't pick up this particular story, and even if they do, they may not even click on that extra feature. It's just wow.
That is mind blowing. That really.
From my point of view, it's such a British thing for something like that to be an extra on a DVD, because you don't normally see anything like that with American things, unless it's on a Criterion movie release. That's the only place where you'll see something obscure, like seemingly obscure, like that.
I think it speaks volumes about the people who make the DVD and now the Blu-ray sets. They're obviously massive fans themselves, and they've just put their heart and soul into it. And they'll just go above and beyond to try and create some content for like-minded fans.
The fact that Iain Levine, you know, fast-forwarded some years, made his own, like, personally produced recreation of the Shada, which was not even used at all, that BBC did their own, which is fine, but...
He did the same thing with Mission to the Unknown as well.
And it was not aware of that, but it, wow, and then to do all that, and then you can never even show it to anyone... Oh my gosh.
It almost makes you feel sorry for him, doesn't it?
Well, actually, I do. I mean, I don't know him at all, and I know there's other controversies that involve him as well, like, very well noted out there. But despite all that, I do feel sorry for him, despite his other less popular decisions.
Yeah, hats off to him. It was a really good recon. And yeah, if you get a chance to pick up a copy, I don't think it's ridiculously expensive to get hold of these days. So,
in the UK, it's not. different matter in the United States. Because I'm sure you guys know, many of the classics were out of print for years, the DVDs. They actually started reprinting some of them about a year ago. Planet of the Giants was one of the ones that was out of print. So it probably soared up to a price of, I want to say, between $75 and $100 to get.
Holy moly.
Oh, that's nothing compared to some of the other stories that went out of print, like Planet of Spiders or The War Games. Many of those topped $100.
I think Two Doctors was another one, wasn't it?
Yes, and several. I mean, probably, I don't know, 60, 70% of the catalog went out of print in the U.S., and then they reprinted some, and Planet of Giants was one of those that got reprinted. But even those reprints, I think, are now becoming scarce, so the prices are starting to creep up again on the reprints. But a while ago, because of all this out-of-print fiasco, I started seeking out the Amazon UK store a lot more. Thank goodness that's an option for me. So this is one of my classic DVDs that I have the UK version of. And not too costly for me to get imported from the UK. Although, because of the pandemic, many shipments from Amazon.uk or .co.uk. it took a while for this, or some of the others I bought prior to this during the pandemic that I needed imported.
Well, we appreciate you going to all that effort.
Oh, my pleasure, though. I always wanted to own it anyway. And then another technical fact that nobody cares about except for Ming Mongs like me. Can I say Ming Mong? Is that still an appropriate
you
doctor
say
term?
You can.
But
activate the Ming Mongs.
A technical aspect that nobody else but few but me care about is, I don't know, you guys know, but because of NTSC versus PAL and how the formats work, I mean, you guys know how PAL has always inherently had a bit better resolution than NTSC, whether on the air or on disk. Absolutely. And so now that I own a few classic DVDs from the UK side, I can see the difference, actually. They are a bit clearer.
I used to work in an electrical store, a Sony dealer, and we used to refer to NTSC as never twice the same color.
Oh, dear. Well, I can see the difference between my UK DVDs and my American counterparts, and it's interesting to me. I mean, it's such a little thing that most people would never notice, but especially in a large television, it makes a little bit of difference. So, yeah, most impressed.
And, of course, this was another momentous story for another reason, because it's the very first instance of music being provided by a certain Mr. Dudley Simpson.
Yes, I did not know that until 3 hours ago today. I had no idea. And also sad that, again, a reviewer from the time, in a publication from the time, said they didn't like the childish like nature of the score of the music.
I think I saw that too. Yeah,
but it's delightful. Didn't know it was Dudley Simpson until 3 hours ago. But also, I do have a thing for a lot of the incidental music, especially in season one of Hartnell, because a lot of it was, I guess, stock sound footage. And it actually gives it a strange, different feel. I actually like a lot of the early episodes because of that stock music feel. But I don't know.
Yeah, they got some really groovy sort of music concrete stuff going on, haven't they? Kind of experimental, sort of pre-digital soundscapes. And the one that really springs to mind is the music from the Daleks, the first Dalek serial.
Oh, yeah.
It sounds very otherworldly, and it's great.
Oh, this is what I was thinking of earlier that I forgot. Because another thing I liked about this episode or story, and of course, I'm pretty sure this came after it. There is a classic episode of The Twilight Zone that is a little bit familiar, a little bit similar to this story. In a way, do you guys have any idea what classic episode of Twilight Zone I'm referring to?
No, I've seen the odd episode, but I'm not really that well versed.
I'm not well versed either, I know of. There was an episode. I don't have.
Is there an episode called Back Garden Tiny Man Cat Peril? Was it something like that?
That is exactly the title. No.
Ah, yes.
I don't know. I don't have it in front of me. I didn't do my due diligence, but it probably had a title something like The Giant or something, or Giant Planet, or who knows what, something like that. I'm gonna spoil it for you guys and everyone else who's hearing this who has never seen it. But it, again, because of scale, it is one of my all time favorite black and white Twilight Zone episodes. But here goes the spoiler. Fast forward if you don't want to have this ruined. But in the story, there appears to be an elderly woman living alone, like in an American country house or something, like a farmhouse, something like that. And based on her style of dress and the way it looks, you're not 100% sure. It could be present day, meaning the 50s, or it could have been prior, unclear, because there's not too many things to give away the time period. But she lives alone, and she's just in her house doing her whatever she does, cleaning, sweeping, whatever. But she starts to think that there's something in her home, and she doesn't know what it is. At first, you think maybe it's a rodent or something, some small creature. There's little things mm-hmm. happening in her home, and she can't explain what they are. And it's starting to make her pretty crazy, because she knows there's something creeping around. And she's going nuts. She's losing her mind, going around chasing these things because, I don't know, little things are falling off the table or she's finding strange little clues.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm going to spoil the climax. She eventually goes up into her attic at the end, and she hears some radio communication, and you hear someone, like, on a radio. By the way, she never speaks in the episode, which is important, but you don't realize until later. But she goes upstairs and she hears, like, I guess a radio communication, and you hear mm-hmm. an American voice saying something like, I don't know if they actually say Houston, but, you know, calling Earth, calling Houston, we've landed and we've encountered hostile creatures, and hostile giants, and da 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 da, and they're calling like a mayday, and she discovers there's this, what looks like a flying saucer with a diameter of maybe 3 or 4 feet that crashed into her attic.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like a flying saucer, but it has like a American flag on it, United States of America. And she realizes these were these little astronauts who were like around her home. And she finally finds them at the end. I think there's a, and then she destroys their saucer, and that's the end of the episode. But, this reminds me of that, is all I'm saying. And I'm sure somebody mm-hmm. in the Doctor Who production at the time, because that episode, I don't know, perhaps came out 3 or 4 years prior to this. I don't know. And so that was probably in the back of someone's mind. Oh, it's one of my favorites. I just spoiled it for everyone.
I'm wondering if that flying saucer with its 4 foot diameter, if that would have effectively plugged the sink in the laboratory in Planet of Giants, because I have a lot of things to talk about with this, but now that that has been raised up as the kind of big gaping hole in the story, I mean, I was going to focus my lamplights on Mr. Forrester and his very small gun. I think that's probably the smallest firearm I've ever seen anyone use in an entertainment. But nevertheless, he does use it very effectively to kill Mr. Farrow. And then there's this insane plan he comes out with, where they're going to put Mr. Farrow back in his boat, send it out to sea, and make it turn over. And the police will assume that Farrow drowned.
No one would ever know.
Like, they won't maybe autopsy him and find an enormous bullet wound in his chest.
Ah, but you missed the crucial point.
Oh, did I? I wondered if I had.
Yeah, the cunning part of his plan was, which would negate all those things you've just talked about, is that he pulled his handkerchief out of his pocket
right.
and put it over the telephone when he made the telephone call.
Oh, I thought you were going to say something else.
They're going to put a really...
That's ensuring that no one would ever know that it was him on the phone.
Oh, yeah, no, you're right. That is practically foolproof.
Mm-hmm.
If only he'd... I mean, it's hard to imagine how he didn't get away with this incredibly carefully calculated scheme. No, but yeah, he was... I don't know the actor's name, and I don't need to apologise. He's dead. But it was, for me, he was a very sort of flat, emotionless, again, kind of disinterested performance, which made me wonder if perhaps he was maybe a very early kind of Cyberman in the way that his emotions had been removed.
Or maybe he's just a massive psychopath and he didn't really give a toss about anyone else apart from himself.
Well, what you're saying there, because obviously he was a businessman, he was someone involved in the sort of medical chemical industry. He was a successful man. You're saying successful men in that industry tend to be psychopaths. Is that what you're saying?
I'm not saying
that. Is that the accusation you're levelling at?
I thought that was exactly what Mark was saying. That's how I read it.
I think that's basically what Mark was saying. If you're listening and you are the head of a large international pharmacological company and you wish to sue Mark Cockrum, please email in to mailbagofrassilon.com.
Now, I do have a few faults to pick. I gave the set some praise, so I'm trying to be even-handed here.
Mm-hmm.
Barbara, what on earth was going on with Barbara? Seriously, she's an intelligent woman. She's the smartest cookie out of the whole bunch of them. What the ever-loving Jeff was going on with Barbara?
I'm gonna appropriately enough, because I'm called Iain, I'm gonna interpose myself between you and Barbara and say, "How very dare you, sir?" She obviously didn't want to cause any trouble by, you know, telling anyone
someone that you picked up a poisonous seed and you might be dying.
You know what teachers are like. They're all they can think about is just get through this, get to the bell, and then I can go around the back of the bike sheds and have a couple of Benson and Hedges.
That is exactly every teacher I've ever known.
Let me hold you up there, Iain. Are you saying that all teachers are just work shy and want to spend all their time hanging around smoking?
No, not work shy at all. They have an absolutely horrible...
If you're a teacher and you've been affected by the words of Mr. Iain Martin, you can sue him through mailbagofrassilon @gmail.com.
They have an awful, very hard 50-minute period. They have a nanosecond to go and have a quick smoke, and then they've got another 5 or 6 lessons, and then they're up till 2 in the morning marking and preparing the next day's lessons.
I think you're clutching at straws.
It's only the smoking, and it's interesting that you never see Barbara or Iain sort of round the back of the TARDIS having a quick gasper. No, I think Barbara is very good. I think I want to say Jacqueline Hill. I always get it wrong. I think this was one of her, and they're all good. She's very consistently brilliant.
It's just, you know.
Yeah, I think she was absolutely
the lines she's been given.
Absolutely cracking form in this one.
There was some beautiful being thrown around in a suitcase acting by young Mr. Iain Chesterton.
Are we opening that can of worms now, Mark?
Well, why not? Let's
so. And regular viewers of this podcast will know that I've often had sort of pause with Iain Chesterton and moments of perhaps not being quite as big of a fan of him as pretty much everyone
You've never
out
mentioned
there
it previously.
But I think he's reached peak bell end in this story. He's just such a total, unrelenting, fatalistic old, drama queen woman kind of, my shoelace has come undone. I must do it up, but in bending down, I might die. He's just everything. It's like, I'll do this, but this could happen, and this would be terrible. And, you know, he can't act like he's being thrown around in a matchbox. To be fair, that's not much of a criticism, because it's not something you do at RADA, I would imagine, you know, a sort of 2-week course on matchbox acting. But, you know, he starts the episode. We've had a break. We've had a month off. This is the start of series 2. We don't know what adventure they might be coming from. But he kicks off the adventure standing round in the TARDIS for no reason in a suit and tie, like he's been to an interview or like he's Alan Partridge. He's standing there dressed like that.
It's the 1960s, Iain. People had standards back then.
Did they, though? I mean... You know, you never saw the Beatles dressed like that again. If you are
look at Barbara, she was very well turned out as well, wasn't she?
Well, I have a real problem with that. So Barbara's wearing this lovely crisp white linen top, and what does the Doctor do? He rubs his hand over the burnt end of a match, and then immediately claps his hands on her upper arms, thus probably ruining her cotton blouse. If I was her, I'd have punched him across the room.
I have a couple of things to say to reflect on what I've just heard. Firstly, back to Barbara for a moment. I would say, to be fair, her brain had been shrunken. So that's one thing. Another thing about...
And she was dying from poisoning.
Oh, yeah, that too, later. And then with Iain and them and their clothing, I wonder if, because I didn't know this either until I was preparing minutes before this discussion. This was the first return in Doctor Who in the series at that time. This was the first time they returned to contemporary present day Earth in the show. I didn't realize that. And perhaps the characters knew or they expected that they were going back to present day Earth. So perhaps they were already dressed that way, anticipating that they would be out and about if the TARDIS landed the way it was supposed to.
The Doctor's still rocking his cloak from the Reign of Terror.
Well, you know, the Doctor's the Doctor.
He's pimping it. He didn't have the hat, though. I mean, that would have really finished it off.
So I'm headcanoning at least why they're dressed the way they're dressed, because it is a bit preposterous. But
well, I could.
I love that stuff.
I could tear apart your argument like tissue paper. If the Doctor's still at least three regenerations away from being able to steer the TARDIS, and the screen blew up as soon as they landed, they could have had no idea where they were going. So I think Iain just dresses like that because he's a git.
I think both things can be true at the same time.
I mean, where do you stand on our Mr. Chesterton?
Well, here's the thing. I can't disagree with what you were saying about him in general, but when I, especially when I go back and watch the Hartnell era, I just roll with things. Otherwise, it would be unwatchable to me. Or I would think any sensible person who's not a diehard Doctor Who fan, it would just outright be unwatchable for the things you point out about Iain and many other things throughout the era. So I just roll with it, and I just take it as funny. All these things that you're talking about, when I come across them in this story or any story, I just think they're funny. Like when he acts like a git, as you say, it's just, it's funny to me. It's silly. It's so silly. But that's just, I don't know, maybe that's my relationship with Hartnell era Doctor Who. I don't know. I just go with it. I think
it's very...
Iain, what? Look, you just need to realize that Iain Chesterton is a player.
He's not a...
Don't hate the player. He's not a player. Hate the game.
He's probably had one girlfriend in his life. So I think it's interesting that as the Hartnell Doctor beds in and it kind of goes through this softening process... Iain goes the other way. I mean, he starts off the first couple of stories, I didn't actively want to punch him, but he just becomes more joyless and more humorless and more insufferably pompous as the series goes on. That might just be my opinion.
I think it's there. I think it absolutely is there. I just don't have the adverse reaction to it for whatever reason. That's just me. But
I think it's because I'm also called Iain, and I feel like he's letting the side down, because we're basically a really cool, chilled out, funky bunch of people, but he's just got this broom up his arse.
it's on the tip of my mind. I know there's other characters like that in Doctor Who and in other places. They're just not coming to me. But I like the
Big Bird, I suppose.
Characters. What's that?
John Pertwee is the kind of next standout, insufferable, pompous twat, I think.
Oh, no. I mean, there's definitely that, but he's the Doctor. But I meant, like, those characters who are just don't really realize where they are or what's going on in the sci-fi premise that they're in, and just carry about just like dunderheads. I'm entertained by that.
That's an infuriating trope, isn't it? I've always been really... I hate that when that happens. And in terms of like sci-fi or fantasy tropes that I can't stand, probably that's my number two. I really can't abide when people are just like willfully blind to what's fundamentally obviously happening. My number one all-time I can't stand this sci-fi trope is the body swap episode where... terrible things keep happening to the hero because they're in the body of the baddie, and you think, oh, they're never going to get it back. And that just, oh, that grinds my gears.
You must have really loved Quantum Leap then.
Oh my gosh. I don't know. It's all true what you're saying. I'm more entertained by it than disgusted, I guess.
Well, I think that makes you a bigger, better person than me. I'm just, but then I'm watching these for the first time, so I'm having the kind of immediate reaction of, say, a 4-year-old child, and that's very much the the sort of space in which I operate. No, as anyone who knows me or works with me will tell you.
Whether it's Doctor Who or other classic film or television, I'm usually really good at adjusting my sensibilities for, you know, the time in which the thing originally aired or screened. Usually. And it can usually get me through all the eras of classic Doctor Who. But even I will admit that when we get to the sixth and especially the seventh Doctor, that even my calibration cannot handle those particular eras when it comes to some of the things that transpire.
I mean, seventh Doctor is just appalling, isn't it? I mean, that's just
it started in the sixth, and then it just went completely off the rails in the
absolutely
the seventh. Right, Cochram, you and me outside. Now, I'm willing to die on the hill that the Seventh Doctor is wonderful. Colin Baker, absolutely.
I'm not necessarily speaking about the Doctors in particular, but the stories and sensibilities of the characters
the era.
Yes.
There's no sense. I mean, I'm midway through a little rewatch of, I started watching all of Tom Baker, and now I'm up to Vengeance on Varos. And I'm finding it such hard going now because it feels like at that point the show kind of forgot it was a family show and it forgot it was supposed to be fun and it was just unrelenting misery and grimness and it really lost its way. But I think it came back brilliantly in the Seventh Doctor's era. But that's a fight we'll have in a long time.
Whoa, I imagine. That is a hot take right there. I mean, I understand the first part of the take, but then to say it came back with the seventh, that's the hot take part.
I don't think you can watch season 26 and not think that was quite good.
Oh, well, that's the best of his three. I mean, I think most people agree with that. Yes. I also
enjoyed 20, I mean, with the exception of Silver Nemesis and elements of Time and the Rani, I think it stands up really well. At the time, I found it unwatchable and embarrassing and appalling, and I couldn't believe this was happening. But you know, 30 years later, it's brilliant.
But you didn't mention Delta and the Bannermen.
And I like sure Delta and the Bannermen.
Oh, okay. A person could certainly like whatever individual story or episode on their own. Just like I like some unpopular stories. I mean, possibly this one right now, Planet of Giants. But you would have to acknowledge how everyone else feels about it at the same time as well, I think. Or not. Because I can't believe it when I watch it now. I just took it as read at the time when it was new, and you know, it is what it is. But when I watch it now, years removed from then, I'm beside myself. Something that Sean, who I have podcasted with a lot over the years, something he used to say long, long, long time ago in podcasting, I can't remember how you would say it, but it was something like he would talk about moments when you're watching classic Doctor Who, let's say at home by yourself, and then you would be embarrassed if a relative or someone just walked in on you. If you were watching particular certain scenes or certain episodes, you wouldn't know how to explain yourself. You would just feel utterly embarrassed if someone just and. That's how I feel about Delta and the Bannermen. If anyone I knew in my regular life who doesn't give a hoot about Doctor Who, certainly classic Doctor Who, if they just walked in on me and I was just watching this child that was painted green in some type of jumpsuit and just all, I wouldn't even know what to say. I'd rather them walk in on me actually watching full-on pornography. I could much easierly explain that. Than if
absolutely,
I was watching Delta
and Bannermen. That doesn't need any explanation. That you'd be fine. I take your point, and I do know exactly what you mean. I've sort of gently started introducing my American wife to the concept of Doctor Who, and we've watched probably I don't know one Eccleston, one Tennant, one Capaldi, one or two Jodies. I don't know that I'd show her some Tom Baker. I'd probably show her some McCoy, but the thought of her ever knowing that the Colin Baker era happened, I would be so mortified that she'd just look at me and say, but this show that you've devoted your life to is palpably rubbish. And I would have no argument.
But she should be fine with the new series. It has gone beyond mainstream, even the United States at this point. So, mm-hmm. I mean, yeah. So that shouldn't be a hard sell.
Iain, surely you can come up with something positive to say about Planet of Giants.
I thought it was absolutely brilliant, and I totally loved it. I feel like it could quite easily have been a four-parter because it was just constant peril and constant spectacle. And, you know, yeah, the effects don't look so good on our HD, ultra crikey, brilliant screens of today, but it would have looked absolutely amazing and mind-blowing on the kind of 4-inch television set.
I still think it looks pretty good,
yeah,
to be fair.
I think so.
Admittedly, I'm in that mindset of watching old TV, but
You know, there were a couple of kind of interesting performances, but nothing you could actually fault. I mean, as much as I joked about Forrester being a bit emotionless, you absolutely would be. He is a murderer. He is a psychopath.
Yeah.
I think you can explain just about everything. Even Susan, I mean, she only had one line, which was she points and screams grandfather, but she does that with aplomb. Hartnell's doctor, again, he's had a little break. He's happier. He's you know, more childlike, more inquisitive. He was wonderful. That Chesterton was in it. And the sets, everything was remarkable and realised really well. And I'm no connoisseur of the scale up or scale down television trope, but I've seen it done a lot worse. And I genuinely really loved this story.
Oh, well, there you go.
Oh, excellent! I'm glad that you're on board with it, Eric.
Yes, everyone knows.
Where does this stand in your estimations in terms of the other stories, Doctor Who stories that have the kind of shrinking of the main characters? Is this
That's difficult because it is very different from the others in that it by and large deals with contemporary Earth, England of the period, and the others are for the most part much more sci-fi oriented. You know, Carnival of Monsters, Invisible Enemy.
Well, let me rephrase it then. Is there a story that just is head and shoulders above all the others in terms of it just ticks all the boxes for you in a let's make the characters tiny
way? It does in that sense, but the way I think about it is it was one of my most enjoyable experiences of going through the Hartnell episodes, the existing ones. And everyone knows why, as aforementioned. But would I call it one of the best Hartnells? I don't know. Like, if I really, really critically wanted to think about it, probably I wouldn't say that. But it's definitely was one of my favorite to watch, and always happy to rewatch it. And it's really easy because I can get bored and disinterested, of course, when watching other Hartnell stories. Not all of them, but some of them, and it obviously keeps me in. It's only 3 episodes, so, you know, it's not even that much of a commitment. And, no, there's nothing for me to get disinterested in. Again, largely because of the visual spectacle. Even though you could pick away at the, you know, the thin plots and the characters only having incidental interaction with the plot and the physical things going on in the story. It doesn't matter. It's amazing to me what they did with the constraints of the production and of the story, because how do you incorporate them having any interaction at all? And it's just remarkably well done, I think, all things considered. You wouldn't even know how to pull this off if you had the budget and time constraints and the technological limitations of the era. And if someone just said, "Here, I want you to produce this for television," what? How in the world even? No, it's impossible. It's preposterous. But I think they pulled it off, all things considered. I did have one other little nitpick, which was, I don't know, maybe water drains work differently in England than they do. The way I understand them in America, but I couldn't really work out how Susan and the doctor climbed up the drain and how that got them into the house or whatever. I don't know how that works, because mm-hmm. if that was in the United States, that would take you to the roof, presumably. And I don't know where you go from there.
Oh, good point.
Yeah. And I couldn't figure that part out, because a drain doesn't normally go into the inside. So that was a little quibble I had, because I felt like, oh, there needed a better way, because that has to suspend my disbelief completely. Unless, again, water drains work differently in England than the way I understand them. I think maybe we should
assume that when they had to truncate episodes 3 and 4, maybe there was this long sort of fantastic journey element where they okay. went up to the roof, and then they got into the attic, and then they got into the water tank, and then they went down through the plumbing, and they had a bit of business at the stopcock. But all that was lost due to time constraints, and maybe they just sort of... Or maybe they fucked up, I don't know.
But other than that, I mean, yeah, I just love it to bits. I really do.
And Mark,
yes,
what's your abiding opinion of this one?
I quite enjoyed it. It's just a change of pace, isn't it? It's something a bit different, because, you know, you get locked into that pattern of, you know, going into the historical and then doing a futuristic one, then historical, then futuristic. So it's nice just to have something that breaks that mold and does something a bit different. So, yeah, I quite enjoyed it. I mentioned being slightly quizzical of Barbara's sudden stupidity. But other than that, I really enjoyed it. I thought it was a lot of fun.
Cool. So should we mark it?
I think we should, yes.
Okay. Eric, out of 10.
Oh. I'm not good with the 10 scale, because I do it in 5 and then I convert it to 10. Kind of like I had to convert my my marks from NTSC to PAL.
Well, maybe because this is a smaller episode, maybe we should shrink the numbering options and do it out of 5 and then scale it up.
Okay, because it's much easier for me to think in increments of 5 than to 10. Because on the 5 scale, and of course, this is just my personal bias included. This sounds a little bit, even for me, sounds a little bit crazy. I'm going to give it a 4. So I guess that converts to an 8.
Okay.
On the metric scale. So, yes.
Okay. Well, I'm going to go for a 4.5, which converts to a 9.
Ooh.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow, you really liked it.
I really did.
I feel like I'm going to let you guys down a bit then. I am going to give it a 3.5. So that scales up to a 7.
Mm.
So I did enjoy it. It's not the greatest story ever, but it's fun for what it is. And it's a nice diversion from the norm.
Well, you can't say fairer than that.
Another comment I want to make about the episode and just the era in general is that I felt it when I was watching the whole season 1 and going to season 2, that I liked that in that early era, and a lot of it was them just finding themselves, you know, with producing the show, but I liked how even more Doctor Who felt like an anthology show at that time. It's always been that way, but I liked because the productions could be so different. Talking about the stock music, yeah. and just the way things were shot and produced. I really liked how, like the Forrest Gump analogy, it was like Doctor Who very much was like a box of chocolates to me when I was revisiting all that, this era, because you really didn't know what to expect in terms of tone and everything. Whereas things, even though Doctor Who remained an anthology show and still had very varying stories, things became more homogenized, I guess, later in the classic period, when they were just used to making things the way they made things. And it's not really until, I guess, when you get to McCoy and then especially the new series, when, again, you get that real different, you don't know what to expect every week. And I love that about Doctor Who, when it really ramps that up, when, oh, I didn't like this one, but it could be totally different next week. So I like that about the classic era, because episodes really do feel
real. Yeah, that's a really good point.
Yeah, if you just go from like the original story, like from an Unearthly Child to the Tribe of Gum and all that business. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the first Dalek story. And then, what is it? He's a Marinus next. If you watch all those back to back to back, wow, the show is all mm-hmm. over the place. And I look at that as a positive when I revisit that.
Oh, it's all good. You know, it's the variety, like you say, it keeps your interest. And that's one of the nice things about this whole rewatch is just to and get into the context of it as well. And, you know, it feels like there's that bit more sort of through line of continuity, having seen them in order, which is just gives it an extra level again for me anyway. So anyway, I think we've had our say now, so I think we should go to some listener feedback.
I've got mail.
So we've had some more audio feedback. This time we've got a message from our friend Ben Schneider down in Indiana.
Listen, I know we have a worldwide pandemic going on and people are wanting to wash their hands more, but please, people, for cripes sakes, before you wash your hands, check the sink for tiny people. And don't flush your Susan.
And thanks for that, Ben. Ian, who have you heard from?
So, very excitingly, we've heard from some guy called J.R. Southall, or Southall, I'm not sure, who says...
Name sounds familiar, rings a bell.
The best thing about Planet of Giants is its evocation of place, the almost genuine sense of having shrunk the regulars. As such, it would have worked much better much earlier as part of the dislocation of the school teacher's storyline, which had basically petered out by this stage, which is a good point. But mm-hmm. I don't know. I feel like it's a nice way to kind of ease the viewer back into the show, you know, back in for a second series of this thing. I like the way it had a fairly gentle vibe. The Crinoid yeah. podcast. Oh, I've got all the celebrities
over. Our friend
here.
Jim.
Says, perhaps it's better where it is, in the sense that they're coming to terms with time and space travel, only to be hit with this left field development. Which, you know, yeah, I think we alluded to that earlier.
Yeah,
it breaks up that monotony. So I agree yeah. with that. And Greg Cox, again on Twitter, very, very pithy review. He's obviously in a bit of a hurry. Didn't have time for a great outpouring of emotion. Just said simply, great sets, dull story.
Well, that's concise. All right, thank you for that. I've got another comment from Jim from the Crinoid podcast. He says, brilliant sets and a decent ecological message, but the full-size characters are a bit odd, and it's frustrating to watch Barbara almost dying because she doesn't want to make a fuss. Yeah, I'm with you all the way there, Jim. We've also heard from Russ from the Gallifrey's Most Wanted podcast, and they say, I like the ambition of the story. It's flawed in some ways for me. The sets are as good as they could be. No worse than Irwin Allen's Planet of the Giants a few years later. Was that Land of the Giants or Planet of the Giants?
I forget.
But yeah, no, they make a really good point there. Eric, who have you got there?
Let's see. I have from Impossible Blog. Sorry, I don't have your Twitter handle in front of me. But they say, the sets are fantastic, but I don't really understand why the production team were so keen to do a shrinking story. The plot's not great either, and some of the guest cast are very inconsistently written, especially the scientist. It's interesting. Everyone loves all the sets, as do I. And I don't know if the production team themselves were actually keen on the shrinking story just because of the technical challenges it would incur. But nice that they still use this story that, as discussed, was discarded as the original opening story for the whole entire mm-hmm. show. So I'm glad they got back to it. Yeah, and we've kind of talked about the plot as well. You can either deal with it or can't, I guess, as a modern viewer. Generally speaking, I can. I fall into that camp. Next up, mm-hmm. I have from at @hamfistedbapvendor, which I don't even know what that means, because I'm not sure what BAP is. but they say, too often derided for a relative thinness of plot, but I always find plenty to appreciate. in parentheses, and I'm fond of the slow reveal style of this era as the team explore their surroundings, close parentheses. Q6 sets are, of course, enduring things of beauty, a remarkable achievement. I'm glad this person brought this up about the slow reveal, because that was the one of the biggest things I noticed myself when I was going through all of the Hartnell era. And I'm a little bit curious what you gents think about it, because when I first started noticing it on my own in earlier stories than this one, I had to suspend my disbelief. Obviously, I can understand. They're on small sets as it is, because my first question is, why are they just reacting to these things because the camera is panning to it? Because these things were obviously in front of the actors before the camera panned. It's as if they know they're being seen or something. You'll notice this a lot if you just go back to like the original Dalek story. As soon as the camera reveals something, oh my gosh, look, what's that? What's that petrified creature that's been sitting there the entire time in front of everyone? So it really threw me at first when I was going through the era myself. I have made peace with it. I understand it. Now I just kind of chuckle to myself whenever I notice it in other stories. How do you guys feel about all that?
I kind of liked the slow reveal in this one, where it built up to that sort of synchronous moment where both pairs of the TARDIS crew realized what was going on at the same time. Although I thought it was, and we're back to that trope about people being willfully obtuse, where Chesterton says, you know, his theory that everything's massive, and Susan says, no, I don't think that's true at all. And he sort of folds his arms and goes, well, what's your theory then? And it's like, well, come on, mate, Occam's razor. If she's saying the things aren't massive, then by definition, she's saying, you've shrunk. Don't be such a pompous twonk. I'm beating that drum again. I'm so sorry. I just want to smack him.
So funny.
I do like a lot of retro TV. I watch quite a bit in different programs, and I think you just kind of get into a bit of a mindset, and I just kind of switch over to that 60s sensibility, and I don't think it really bugs me that much. Whereas I can imagine for someone who's used to watching particularly new Doctor Who and then trying this out for the first time, they might really see a jarring difference. But I think I've just become a sort of blinded to it, I guess.
Interesting, because I can never fail to notice it when I encounter it. Like I said, I just can kind of just giggle at it now. But I am always keenly aware of and it's such a staple and a mark of the early era of Doctor Who in particular. But, okay, I'm just glad someone brought it up so we could talk about it.
Well, Eric, thank you so much for coming on. It's been wonderful having you on the show.
Always my pleasure. Please, listeners to the show, send the host copious amounts of feedback so that perhaps this could happen again sometime. I would be delighted.
Well, of course we'll have you back. Do you want to give a little plug to anything you've got on the go at the moment before you could disappear?
I will just simply say that if you really, really love movies in general, especially older movies, do check out the latest thing I've been doing on a consistent basis, which is the Best Picture Podcast with Sean, who used to be part of TARDIS Tavern back in the old days. We have a lot of fun talking about old Oscar nominees from randomized years. And so definitely that's the best place to find me. And I'm still the odd appearance. I still have that on the old Sci-Fi Party Line as well. So there you go. And who knows?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
Maybe there's more Doctor Who and Star Trek from me in the future, but I'm not going to talk about that yet.
Maybe one day you will come back. Yes, one day.
Thanks again for listening, and we'll be back next time with another encounter with the Daleks. So until then, I was Mark.
I was Iain.
I was Eric. And until next time, don't panic.
If you'd like to get in touch, you can email us at mailbagofrassilon@gmail.com We're also on Twitter at Time and Space Pod, and you can also find us on Facebook. If you want to leave some audio feedback, there is a link in the show notes. You can use your phone or your computer and leave up to 60 seconds of feedback. Or if you're listening via the Anchor website, you can click on the message button and leave your audio. We'd love to hear from you. And thank you to Momo Tempo for providing our theme music.